हाय फ्रेंड्स, माय नेम इज चंदन एंड वेलकम बैक टू माय चैनल एनर्जी एंड एनवायरमेंट एजुकेशन। फ्रेंड्स, दिस इज वेरी इंपॉर्टेंट चैप्टर फर्नेस एंड दिस इज पार्ट बी ऑफ द चैप्टर। आई हैव डिवाइडेड द एंटायर चैप्टर इनटू डिफरेंट पार्ट्स। पार्ट ए ऑलरेडी आई हैव मेड वीडियो एंड अपलोडेड इन माय चैनल। सो इफ यू हैव नॉट सीन येट, इफ यू मिस दैट पार्ट ए, प्लीज गो थ्रू द पार्ट ए फर्स्ट एंड यू कैन कम बैक टू पार्ट बी। बोथ द पार्ट्स आर इक्वली इंपॉर्टेंट एज फॉर एग्जाम इज कंसर्न। आई हैव गिवन नंबर ऑफ टिप्स इन दैट पार्ट ऑल्सो एंड इन दिस पर्टिकुलर वीडियो ऑल्सो आई एम गोइंग टू गिव यू नंबर ऑफ टिप्स विच कैन हेल्प यू टू क्रैक द एग्जाम फॉर द एनर्जी ऑडिटर एग्जाम इफ यू आर सेटिंग दिस ईयर और इन कमिंग ईयर्स और फॉर द एनर्जी मैनेजर एग्जाम। दिस वीडियोज आर वेरी मच इंपॉर्टेंट फ्रेंड्स। सो आई हैव मेड नंबर ऑफ वीडियोज ऑन डिफरेंट चैप्टर्स दैट यू कैन गो थ्रू एंड दिस हेल्प यू रियली फॉर योर एग्जाम प्रिपरेशन फ्रेंड्स। होपफुली दिस वीडियो ऑल्सो गोइंग टू हेल्प यू आउट इन योर एग्जाम प्रिपरेशन अ बेटर वे एंड द टिप्स दैट आई एम गिविंग यू मे हेल्प यू आउट to understand the different type of questions that can come in the exam friends. So let's start today's video, furnace part B of the chapter friends. So in this part basically I'm going to discuss about two important topics, that is the heat transfer in furnaces. It's a small topic but it's very important topic as the exam is concerned, and the other part is the continuous heating furnaces. So I'll show you different type of furnaces which is very much important for you to understand as for exam is concerned, where a lot of questions can come as per the, you know, where they may ask you to differentiate between the different type of furnaces and also their working principles, their advantages, their disadvantages. So all these things I'm going to deal with in this particular video friends. So please watch the entire video and hopefully this video will help you out to prepare your exam in a better way friends. So coming to the heat transfer in furnaces, friends, you must have read about the heat transfer mechanism in your school days, where the heat transfer takes place by three different processes. First process is the conduction, second process is the convection, and the third process is the radiation. Likewise in the case of furnace friends, here there are two different, you know, processes are taking place. Heat transfer mechanism, you can say the first one is the radiation and the other one is the convection. In the case of radiation, there is no medium is required, while in the case of convection the gaseous medium is required to transfer the heat from the flame to the steel stock which is to be heated here. So you can see in the picture here the steel stock is kept here, the flame is here. Now heat has to be transferred from the flame to the stock, so there are two different processes are applied here. The first one is radiation, where there is no medium is required, directly the heat from the flame is transferred to the steel stock. In the second case, convection medium, convection mode is there, I mean convection process is there, where the gases is used to transfer the heat from the flame to the, you know, steel stock. So the steel stock is heated by two methods or two processes. First one is radiation and the other one is the convection. So this is the all about the heat transfer mechanism in the furnaces friends. Now coming to the types of continuous reheating furnace, this is also important part of the chapter friends, where they may ask you different type of questions in the exam, basically on the, you know, types of reheating furnace. Either they may ask you to explain different types of reheating furnace, in that case you have to name it and then explain it, or they may give you the diagram and then they may ask you to name the different parts of the diagram and also explain the entire process of the reheating furnace friends. Also they may ask you to differentiate between the different types of reheating furnaces. So I'm going to explain you all the different types of reheating furnaces which is given in the chapter friends, and these are equally important because a lot of the questions you may expect in the exam as a short essay type question or maybe a part of long essay type question friends. So coming to the types of reheating furnace or continuous reheating furnace, first of all you must understand friends, continuous reheating furnaces are primarily characterized by the method by which the stock is transported through the furnace. This is one of the most important part where you must understand friends how the continuous reheating furnaces are categorized. So basically it is categorized by the method by which stock is transported through the furnaces. So there are two methods by which the stock can be transported through the furnace. I also show you in the picture, then you can understand in a better way how this transfer of the stock can be done in the furnace friends. First thing is the stock is butted together to form a stream of material that is pushed through the furnace. So in this case what you are doing is you are placing all the stocks in a single frame and they are butted together to form a stream of material, and then it is pushed inside the furnace and then it is getting heated friends. Such furnaces are called the pusher type furnaces. So by the name also you can understand what type of furnace it can be. Also I'll show you in the diagram, friends. Second is the stock is placed on the moving hearth. Now in this case what happens, the hearth is fixed, you are placing the stock and pushing it inside the furnace, and then the heated part of the stock is then removed or discharged, you can say. So one end you are charging it, other one it is discharged. In this case what happens, in this case just contrary to the first type, in this case the hearth where the stock is placed is also moving. It's a moving hearth, or the supporting structure on which the stock is placed is also moving. Stock is placed on a moving hearth or supporting structure which transports the steel through the furnace. So the difference you can see here from both the types, in this type the hearth is not moving, the stock is moving and getting heated inside the furnace. In this case what happens, in this case the stock is not moving, in this case the hearth itself is also is hearth, or you can say the supporting structure is itself moving and heating the entire stock inside the furnace, friends. Such type includes the walking beam, walking hearth, rotary hearth and continuous recirculating bogie furnaces. So I'll explain you all these type of different furnaces in this coming slides, friends, in this particular video. But first of all you must understand the different types of, or the two types of heating mechanism which is taking place here, friends. So coming to the pusher type furnace, friends, so you can understand by the name itself, it's a pusher type where the stock is pushed inside the furnace. The hearth on which the stock is placed is fixed, and the stock is, stock, this is the material which has to be heated, is pushed inside the furnaces and it is discharged off after it is getting heated. The pusher type furnace is popular in steel industry. It has relatively low installation and maintenance cost compared to moving hearth furnace. The furnace may have a solid hearth, but it is also possible to push the stock along skids with water cooled supports that allow both the top and bottom faces of the stock to be heated. So one thing you understand here, the hearth is fixed, stock is moving, stock is getting pushed, and also the top and bottom faces of the stock can be heated here, friends. So this is the, if they ask you to explain about the pusher type furnaces, these are some of the key points that you can highlight while writing in the exam. And also if they ask you to differentiate between the pusher type furnace with the other type of furnaces, these are the key points that you can highlight here, friends. So in this case both the top and bottom faces of the stock can be heated. Second thing is that the hearth is fixed and the stock is movable, that can be pushed inside the furnace, friends. So as I said in the last slide, friends, this is that picture of the pusher type furnace, where you can see the, this is a charge end and this is the discharge end. In the charge end what happens, you are putting the stocks here which has to be heated inside the furnace, and it is a discharge end where the heated stock has to be removed or gets removed here, friends. This is the soaking zone where the actually the heating is taking place, where the stock is getting heated. This is the picture of the stock which has to be heated. This is the hearth, which is a fixed type hearth, you can say. So we are placing the all the stocks here at the charge end, and then slowly it is getting pushed up, and as it gets pushed up, it enters the soaking zone where the entire heating is taking place, and finally it is getting discharged here. This is the entire process of the pusher type furnace, friends, or you can say the working principle of the pusher type furnace, friends. So I hope, friends, you must have got an idea how the pusher type furnace works, or the working principle of the pusher type furnace, where the hearth is a solid structure, it's a fixed type structure, and the moving part is the stock, friends. So stock is basically is moving or pushed inside the furnace. That's the working principle of the pusher type furnace. So just you can imagine what can happen in that case. So basically this is the first disadvantages with the pusher type furnace, where the frequent damage of refractory hearth can take place, or also the skid marks can be also can be there on the material, because the material or the stock is pushed inside the furnace and the hearth is a fixed part. So in this case there may be some possibility that the hearth can get damaged, and also there may be some skid marks left on the material, friends, which is not desirable. Second thing is the water cooling energy losses. So when you are skidding it, so it there is some friction ongoing between the hearth and the stock. So when you are pushing the stock, in that case what happens, a lot of heat is generated which has to be cooled, and where the water is required for cooling purpose. So in this case what happens, a lot of energy losses is going on. So this is also a bit of disadvantage, friends, in the case of furnace system, or you can say pusher type furnace system, friends. Discharge must be accompanied by charge. Now when you're pushing it, so you can understand when it is getting discharged, you must accompany with the charge also, friends. This means you are charging the stocks and finally it getting discharged. This should be a continuous process, because if you're only charging it, and if it's not discharging it will be a problem. Also, if you are only discharging it and if you are not charging it, then the materials will not be lined up, or the stocks will not be piled up. In that case, what happens, pusher type furnace will not work exactly what it should do. So this is also important problem here, friends, that must be highlighted. That is, the discharge must be accompanied by a charge. Stock sizes and weights and furnace length are limited by friction and possibility of stock pileups. So if you're not discharging it properly, so what will happen, more and more charging will be there, and stock piling can be an issue, friends. And also frictions is there, so a lot of heat will be generated, friends. All around heating of the stock is not possible. As I showed you in the last slide, that the top and bottom of the stock can be heated up. So all around heating cannot be possible in this type of furnace, friends. So these are some of the disadvantages of the pusher type furnaces, which can be asked in the exam, either to explain the entire working principle of the pusher type furnaces, and also can be accompanied with the this type of disadvantages of the pusher type furnace, friends. So it's a very important part as far as exam is concerned. Number of questions can come from this part of chapter, friends. Now the second type is the walking hearth furnace. So you can understand by this term only, the what can be expected from this type of furnaces, walking hearth. So if you compare the last slide or the last type of furnace, where the fixed type of hearth is there, the structure on which the stock is piled up is a fixed type. Hearth is fixed. Here the hearth itself is moving. So walking hearth furnace, by the name only you can understand what type of furnace can be possible here. So there are some of the advantages where this type of furnace is very much useful. First of all, it has having the simplicity of design, ease of construction, ability to cater for different stock sizes, negligible water cooling. Here there is no friction loss going on, so in that case any water for the cooling purpose is not required, so you can expect to have negligible water cooling energy losses, and minimal physical marking of the stock, because you can understand that there is no friction between the hearth and the stock, so there is no marking, also or skid mark will be on the stock. There is no possibility as such in this case of type of furnace, friends. So these are some of the advantages with this type of furnaces, which can be remembered and also can be explained when they ask you to explain the walking hearth furnace, or maybe they may ask you to compare with the pusher type furnace, friends. So you can see here the difference between the two types of furnaces, the pusher type furnaces and the walking hearth furnaces, friends. And also you can see here the main disadvantage of walking hearth furnace, that the bottom face of the stock cannot be heated. So in that case, in the case of pusher type furnace, you can see here the top and bottom was heated, but in this case only the top face of the stock can be heated, bottom face of the stock will not be able to heat it. So this is a major disadvantage in the case of walking hearth furnace, friends. Consequently, the stock residence time may be long. So this is also one of the disadvantages, because stock residence time may take too long to I mean may require too long time, friends. So this is also an important point that you must consider in this type of furnaces, friends. So this is the picture of the walking hearth type furnace, friends. So in the picture also you can see here, as I explained in the last slide, that the stock is not moving by itself. There's no pushing is required to the stock. The beam on which the stock is placed is moving inside the furnace, and ultimately the stock is getting heated up, friends, inside the furnace, friends. So this is the moving beams which has been shown here. Also stocks are piled up which has been placed here, and also you can see the burners inside the furnace, friends. It's a very important picture. They may ask you to explain the entire diagram or against the entire picture, friends, and also briefly explain the working principle of the working hearth type furnace, friends. Now coming to the third type of furnace, that is the rotary hearth furnace. As the name suggests, it's a rotary type, which means the entire furnace is rotating, friends. So you can see in the picture also, this is the moving hearth which is ultimately rotating inside the furnace. This is the burner which is heating the stocks, and these are the stocks which are piled up on the hearth, which is ultimately rotating here, friends. So as the name suggests, you can understand entire structure of the, or you can say the entire working principle of the rotary hearth furnace, friends. The rotary hearth has, however, a more complex design. This is a very much important point that you must understand. If you compare other furnaces with the rotary furnace, this type of furnace, although it looks simple, but it is having a complex design with an annular shape and revolving hearth, friends. So it may look simple in this diagram here, friends, but it's not so simple to design. It's a very much complex, type of furnaces if you compare with the other furnaces, friends. So this is very much important as far as exam is also concerned, because they may ask you to briefly explain the rotary hearth furnace, also the working principle of this type of furnaces, friends. And coming to the fourth type of furnaces, that is the continuous recirculating bogie type furnaces. So you can see by the name only, you must understand what this type of furnace this is all about. The bogie type furnace, this means bogie, you can understand, imagine about the bogie of the train, you can see, friends. So basically this type of furnace looks like a train only. The stock is piled on a bogie with a refractory hearth which travels through the furnace with others in the form of a train. So you can just imagine the different bogies of a train. In the same way here, the different bogies are placed on which the stock is piled up, and those bogies travel throughout the furnace as a train, and ultimately the entire stock is getting heated up. The entire furnace length is always occupied by bogies. So basically it should be a long furnace where the entire furnace is covered up by different number of bogies, and in all the bogies the stocks are piled up, and slowly the bogies move inside the furnace, and ultimately the stocks getting heated up. So bogie furnaces tend to be long and narrow, and to suffer from problems arising from the inadequate sealing of the gap between the bogies and the furnace shell. This is the disadvantage of the bogie type furnace, friends, where the space is too little there. So in that case, what happens, the removing the scale is a difficulty here in removing the scale, and difficulty in firing across the narrow hearth width. So these are some of the disadvantages of this type of furnaces, friends. So this you can understand here with the help of the picture here, which is already given here. It's very easy to understand if you see this picture. This is a charge end and this is the discharge end. So in the charge end, the stocks are charged, or you can say placed, and this is the discharge end, where from where the material of the stock has been gets removed here, friends. So you can see the burner also is placed, and you can see just the type of placement here, just like the train. These are the different bogies on which the stocks are piled up. So these bogies ultimately moves inside the furnace, and these stocks ultimately gets heated up as the bogies are moving inside the furnace, friends. So this is very important picture. You can expect to have this thing in the exam, and also you must be able to write it down if they ask you to briefly explain this type of furnaces, friends. It's a very easy explanation, you can understand, and it's a very easy to understand if you imagine this type of furnace if you compare it with a train, friends. So very much easy to understand and very much important as far as exam is concerned, friends. And another type of furnace is a working beam furnace, where the the stock is placed on a beam which is ultimately moving, and this is the charge and a charge, or you can say the stock is getting charged here and it's discharged from this end. Ultimately what happens, as the beam moves, the stock also moves inside the furnace and gets heated up. So it's also very much easy to understand this type of working principle of this type of furnaces, friends. This is a charge end, this is a discharge end, these are the stocks which has been piled up, and this is a moving beams. So ultimately what happens in this type of furnaces, the beams on which the stocks are piled up are ultimately moving, not the stocks, friends. So the beams are moving and the stocks are getting heated up inside the furnaces, friends. So this type of furnace also is very much important as far as exam is concerned, and they may ask you to briefly explain this type of furnace, and also they may ask you to briefly explain differentiate between the different types of furnaces which I have explained you in the different slides, friends, in this particular video. So with this I am ending the part B of the chapter, friends, and we'll continue with the part C in the coming video. Hopefully this particular video has given you some insights and important tips on the exemption concerned, and from this part of chapter, friends, and hopefully the other video also going to help you out in your exam preparation. So please watch the other videos like part A. If you have missed it out, please watch that video, and also other videos that I have posted on this channel on different chapters, friends. Please do not forget to watch those videos. They may help you out to prepare your exam in a better way, friends. And also part C will be uploaded in a short few days time. So stay connected and watch the other parts also of this particular chapter and other videos, friends, that I'm going to post in this channel in coming days, friends. And last not the least, if not yet, please do subscribe my channel, friends. This is my YouTube channel, Energy Environment Education. I am posting number of videos on, you know, energy auditor, energy manager exam that may help you out to prepare for your exams, and friends. This is my mobile number 8800671509. And also this is my email ID where you can post your queries, any inputs if you want to have, or any suggestion if you want to post those things. You can post it on my email ID, friends. And this is my channel. Please do subscribe it, friends. If not yet, this will motivate me to prepare more such videos in coming days. And also please press the bell icon such that you get an instant notification as soon as I post a new video in coming days, friends. So stay connected, stay safe, and please do watch my all other videos. If you have missed it, this may help you out to prepare your exam in a better way, friends. Thank you for your watching and sparing time with me, friends. Thank you.